When it comes to designing engines, there's a lot that goes into producing an engine that's going to be both powerful and reliable. We're here with David Mountune, founder of Mountune. Mountune are no strangers to performance engines, building and designing engines that have won championships in the likes of WRC, British Touring Cars, World Touring Cars, and Rallycross. And we're here to find out a little bit about their World Rallycross engine. So for a start, David, the World Rallycross engine, I mean, in outright power numbers, it's certainly not the most powerful engine in the world. Can you tell us sort of what sort of power level these engines are producing?
Okay, they're all around 600 horsepower. The reason why they're only 600 is because the regulation states we have to have a 45 millimeter air restrictor fitted to the turbo. So in terms of power, it's controlled by the mass airflow. But torque, you know, where we can put the boost in at the bottom end, you know, 850 newton meters of torque isn't uncommon. So
now, just going back to that restrictor, so essentially this is a concept that's been used in rallying for decades, and it's a leveling aspect. So regardless of the manufacturer of the engine, regardless how clever the person is on the computer keyboard doing the tuning, that restrictor limits the airflow. So that's the idea of trying to get all of the engines producing similar power numbers.
Exactly right. It's a very old system that's been around certainly as long as I have. The great thing about it is it's very easily checked by the scrutineer. You know, there's a no-go gauge effectively, so if it's the right size hole, and basically it's very simple, so it's all about trying to get, you know, the biggest bang for, you know, for your pound of airflow consumption. So it's about efficiency really, but it's a great way of leveling power.
Now, the thing that's important to understand with that restrictor as well, and you've sort of touched on this, you mentioned that you may only be making 600 horsepower, but the torque is actually quite impressive with these engines. So where the restrictor sort of starts clamping down on airflow is more in the higher RPM range, is that fair?
Exactly right. So if you look at where we make peak power at about 6,500 RPM. So where the restrictor is not limiting the airflow, we can put the boost pressure in, and then very rapidly we have to decrease the boost pressure, otherwise we'll overspeed the turbo, and that then puts the turbine back pressure up, which then causes detonation and all those things. So
boost control on these engines is really critical.
Absolutely critical, yeah.
And what sort of boost pressure are you using down at that low RPM range where you're not airflow restricted through the restrictor?
We're using around 3 bar at the bottom end, and that drops quite rapidly to around about a bar at the top end.
Now, when you've got an engine like this that on face value, we look at the numbers and we see everything in magazines with what engines are producing, 600 horsepower these days, we're seeing road cars making this sort of power quite easily. So on face value, it doesn't sound like it's that difficult. But can you talk to us about why that low RPM torque actually makes it really hard to get reliability out of the engine?
Yeah, well, I mean, we end up with, you know, with cylinder pressures of, you know, well, we've seen as high as 250 bar. So we're talking about, you know, high performance diesel engine type cylinder pressures. So the Achilles heel has always been the head joint, you know, because our cylinder pressures are so high.
So when you're saying the head joint there, what you're talking about is that interface between the engine block and the cylinder head. In other words, head gasket integrity, holding the cylinder head on the engine and holding all of that pressure in the cylinder.
That's exactly right, because every time the engine fires, you know, if you was to put a load cell across the cylinder head and block, it's bouncing like this. And you've just got to keep, you know, you've got to keep the seal. And that's why we use a very flexible head gasket that's like a spring, and it's moving with the head all the time. And the minute you get any leakage, it's game over very, very quickly. We're talking in terms of seconds.
Yeah, I think it's really easy for those who aren't operating at this level to look at a cylinder head or an engine block sitting on a workbench, and obviously it's nice and rigid and strong sitting there, but as you've mentioned there, you don't take into account the fact that these components are actually flexing under that high level of pressure. Now, coming from a drag racing background myself, this, as you say, is always the Achilles heel of the engine.
Right.
How much boost we can run into it comes down to how well we can hold the cylinder head on it. And there are a huge range of technologies available, from stainless O-rings to gas-filled O-rings. You've basically suggested there you're using what sounds like a relatively conventional multi-layer steel head gasket. Is that correct?
It is. We've tried over the years, we've tried, you know, Cooper O-rings, we've tried Wills rings, beryllium rings, all of these things. And actually, the best compromise we found is a multi-layer steel head gasket. But there's an awful lot of technology. I mean, we work with ElringKlinger, who, you know, German company, and they make high-performance gaskets for a lot of the OEs, and they have a small department that does prototype gaskets, and we've just found that it's the best, gives us the best solution.
So you're not clearly talking about your typical factory replacement MLS gasket from your local parts supplier. This is a very specialist piece of equipment.
It's a very specialist piece of equipment that's very expensive. I mean, a typical figure of, you know, around $300 for a head gasket, and we have to buy a quantity and we have to pay for the tooling. There's a lot goes into the head gasket, massive amount.
All right, so the head gasket, though, really is only one part of the whole strategy of, of getting the head and block to seal. And I think, again, this is an area that's easy to overlook. Difficult when you're dealing with OE castings because is what it is. Yeah. But particularly aspects such as the way the head studs or bolts are located in the block and the thickness of the deck surface of both the block and the head can play a factor. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you've dealt with those problems and overcome them?
Yes, I mean, you know, you're absolutely right. It's the structure of the whole thing assembled and clamped up, which is important. So if you try and increase the clamp load too much and you've got an OE head cast in, you start collapsing the head pillars, then you lose the clamp load. So if we're using OE heads and blocks, we have to start off by understanding how strong is that structure, what can we do to improve it. Typically, we'll try and get a longer stud down into the block if there's material to do it. Typically, a slightly larger diameter if we can, so we can increase the clamp load. But then we do tests on what the whole integrity is to see at which point does the thread start pulling from the block, does the pillar start collapsing, and it's that whole balancing act.
So I think, again, just relating this back to our streetcar market, it's very common for people when they're building a slightly modified engine to buy an off-the-shelf set of head studs to replace the factory bolts and torque them up a little bit more and you think everything's fine. But basically what you're saying there is you can actually be creating as many problems as you're solving by using more clamping force.
100%. You know, if you take an OE engine, you know, the OEs spend a lot of money developing their head bolts, and they're often now stretch bolts, so they go to a certain yield. And quite often you can put a bolt in there that in effect is too solid. When it goes through a heat cycle, then you lose your clamp load. So there's a lot more to it than just fitting a stud in and clamping it down.
Right, so once you've actually got an engine that's capable of handling that cylinder pressure and is reliable, really it still comes down to the turbocharger that's in really the part of the puzzle that's creating the airflow, and that's central to the performance of any turbocharged engine. So on the World Rallycross engines, you're not running a sort of turbo that we could buy off the shelf. This is a very specialist turbocharger developed specifically for the application. Can you talk to us about that turbo?
Yeah, it's really a truly remarkable piece of kit. You know, I think I mentioned to you earlier, if I go back some years when we started in World Rally Car, for instance, or it was called Group A Rally Cars back in those days, we had to use modified standard production turbos. And it was not uncommon to have to change a turbo at the end of each day. So you had to cart around your spare turbo in the car. Those were the regulations. And then we finally bit the bullet and we went to a proper racing turbo made by Garrett in the US. And it was a complete game changer. You know, we could do multiple rallies on one turbo. Specially developed materials, you know, for high temperatures, high speeds. And the guys, you know, just a fabulous job. It's not cheap, but in the long run it is actually.
The other thing with these, it's a TR30R from what I understand. And these are, again, while you say TR30R, this is really a family of turbochargers. So you work with Garrett to develop the specification of turbocharger to give you the response and power that you want for the particular application?
That's absolutely correct, yeah. It's a family that has a wide range. So we work with the engineers at Garrett in terms of what we need in terms of a compressor map and airflow to suit the actual requirement. And they've got such a database now, they pretty quickly tune into what we need.
Now, I think another thing that's important to point out, we don't really consider this in the enthusiast market, but the weight of all of the components is obviously critical. And that TR30R, because it's a motorsport-only turbocharger, Garrett don't need to meet OE burst retainment regulations. So all of the castings, very, very thin, very, very light, so it's a huge weight saving.
Absolutely. You know, in world-class motorsport, like World Rally Car, for instance, people pay money to save weight. And you're exactly right, special materials to save weight. But yeah, we don't have the burst containment, and someone in the company is going to have to sign that off, you know, so there's no liabilities that come back. But they are, so if you run them within the spec, they're very, very reliable.
Now, the other aspect that you can't overlook on this engine, because it's right there in front of your face, is the anti-lag system. So we've seen a lot of ways that anti-lag can be used, and in the easiest way, a way we see in European rallying that I've been involved with in the past, we simply crack the throttle body open, that bypasses air through the engine, we add fuel, we retard the timing, and we get the combustion event happening much later in the engine cycle to provide energy to the turbocharger to spool it. But you've got a much, much more complex take on that with a fresh air valve. Can you just talk us through that system and how it works?
Yeah, I mean, we started off with exactly what you described. Early days of anti-lag was exactly that, bypassing the inlet side. And what we found was the more aggressive we needed to make the system, basically we had zero engine braking, lots of push on, drivers didn't like it. So we started to develop what we now call a fresh air system, where we're actually pumping compressed air into the exhaust. And it gets really neat when you've got direct fuel injection, because then you can put fuel into the exhaust on the exhaust stroke. You have a lot more control. So effectively, we can make the system very, in fact, almost too aggressive if we want it to be, and not lose our engine braking.
I'll just come back to that, because a lot of people watching may not understand what you're talking about when you say push, and just to sort of reiterate there. So essentially with the conventional anti-lag system that I was talking about, if you want to make it more aggressive, you open the throttle further, that bypasses more air. But of course, we're combusting some of that fuel and air still in the engine, and it creates power. So essentially when the driver gets off the throttle, the car is actually still trying to drive forward, and that's what you mentioned you were talking about when you say push.
That's what I mean by push on. So the driver's coming into a corner, lifts off the throttle, expects to have, quite rightly, a certain amount of engine braking, hasn't got any, he's harder on the brakes, so the brakes wear out more quickly, and it particularly on circuit racing, it's very difficult.
Now, with that system, can you give us some numbers around what sort of boost pressure you're seeing pre-throttle body? Now, admittedly, when you're off the throttle, well, the driver's off the throttle, you've still got the throttle body closed, so you're not necessarily seeing positive boost pressure in the inlet manifold, but I think that's the part people overlook. You've still got positive boost pressure pre-throttle body, so that turbo's spooled, ready to go as soon as the throttle's cracked again. So can you give us some numbers around that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, typically now, particularly if we're talking about, you know, the latest DI engines with fresh air, you know, if you look at the turbo speed relative to throttle angle, stays pretty constant. So even at idle, you've got you've certainly got well over 100,000 RPM turbo speed. So you're dead right, your turbo's spooled up, ready to go. And the minute you crack the throttle, it's there. So it's a big difference.
And I think I'll just come back as well and talk about that DI, the aspect there that's important. With a conventional port-injected engine, we really are injecting the fuel and it's going to the cylinder when the intake valves are open. So it's being introduced to the cylinder during the intake stroke. But of course, with direct injection, you can place that injection event anywhere in the engine cycle. So I'm guessing you're basically placing it during the exhaust stroke.
Exactly right, yeah. I mean, so we're putting fresh air into the exhaust manifold. We're putting fuel into the exhaust manifold. and that's it, you know.
Complete control over the anti-lag system.
So we're kind of running the turbo like a gas turbine, really, and coupling the two together. So yeah, it's the difference, you know, if you go in a car with a professional driver and you switch the anti-lag on and off, it's just amazing difference.
Now we'll switch across to the other side of the engine. On the inlet manifold, there's a couple of things that I just wanted to talk about. And the first is the design of the plenum and the intake manifold itself. You've got a drive-by-wire throttle body that's mounted quite low. And it's just interesting the way you're introducing air into the body of the plenum chamber itself. A little unconventional compared to some of the factory plenum designs we see. Where are the advantages in that design?
Yeah, well, particularly with Rallycross, where you can either use port throttles, but you have to have a throttle cable, or you can have a single fly-by-wire throttle. And, you know, if we didn't have the anti-lag so well developed, we would still be really stuck on port throttles, because you get very good throttle response, you get the boost building up against the back of the butterflies are close to the valve, you get very, very good throttle response, but you're limited to a throttle cable. With the fly-by-wire throttle, you can play tunes with what the throttle's doing relative to the driver's pedal. And because the anti-lag system works so well, we manage the throttle response. So
just for those viewing who haven't heard that term, when you're saying port throttles, really you're talking about what we'd refer to as individual throttle bodies, but the regulations there state individual throttle bodies must be cable, single throttle, drive-by-wire.
That's exactly correct, yeah.
Right. The other aspect there is you've got dual injectors per inlet runner. So I'm guessing you're running some sort of staged injection strategy there?
Yes. On the PFI engines, we tend to use two injectors per cylinder because we just need the fuel flow. Mm-hmm. And we get better performance by basically running one injector at relatively low engine power outputs, and we bring the second injector in at a higher boost level. We just get a better spread of power, basically.
All right. Now, just talking about the oiling system on these engines, generally when we look at rally cars operating on gravel, the amount of lateral load that they can generate can be a little bit less than what we'd expect to see in a circuit car, for example.
Yes.
Is the oiling system on a World Rallycross engine similar to rallying, or given that they're operating on both tarmac and gravel or dirt, do you sort of go with a more sort of circuit-orientated oiling system?
Well, a lot of this is driven by regulations. Rallycross, we use dry sump oil systems, and in relatively recent years, we've been allowed to use dry sump in rallying. In some forms of touring car, like British touring car, the regulations state we still have to use wet sumps. And there's a big challenge with the wet sump. And I've stated for a long time that I think it would actually be cheaper to allow us to use dry sump.
Sometimes those cost savings actually end up to be more of a larger cost than they're intended.
Like losing an engine because of oil surge, you know.
No one wants that. No. Look, David, it's been great to get some insight into what goes into a World Rallycross engine. Thanks for your time there. If people want to find out more about what you do at Mountune, how can they reach out?
The best things go on our website, which is mountune.com, and have a look.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.